Hello and welcome back. We're going to look at just a short session on risk assessment, primarily because question one in the P7 exam almost always, if not always, focuses on risk. Now we'll look in more detail in the next session about the actual risks you will need to identify, but I want to think here about the risk assessment process under ISA 315. So I want to think why we do it. I want to think what you need to do during the risk assessment and when it happens. So first things first, it happens in the planning period. So that will be prior to the year end. And there are three required procedures. So ISA 315 says it's compulsory to carry out three particular procedures. Now you will carry out others, but this gives you guidance as to what the standard thinks are important in gaining an understanding and making a risk assessment of the entity. So, number one, the first procedure is inquiries of management. So, we need at this stage, when developing an idea of the risks, to talk to management about how they have prepared the accounts, to talk about the various ownership issues there may be. Maybe they've become a listed client. Whatever it happens to be, we need to talk to management. We need to understand what they have done and why they have done it. Number two, the second requirement is that we must undertake analytical procedures. And we will almost always have to do this in the exam. You will almost always have some financial information that is given to you. You need to look at that in order to identify risk areas. For example, let's say that gross profit has been 50% year on year for several years, and suddenly this year gross profit is 70%. Well, what could the risk be? The risk is that our cost of sales is understated. So either there's been some window dressing where cost of sales have been maybe pushed into next year, or maybe they've been misallocated, misposted into our other expenses rather than cost of sales. So by undertaking analytical procedures, simply looking and doing some calculations on the figures, we can start to understand where the risk areas are, and that is absolutely fundamental for your P7 paper. The examiner is continually going on that one of the worst things to do in the P7 paper is to ignore the numbers. I know it's an audit paper, but this is an accountancy qualification. If you ignore the numbers in P7, you are making a massive mistake. Because to be honest, that's where the easy marks are. You will get one mark for a calculated ratio with an analysis of the trend. That's easy marks when it comes to P7, and believe me, there are not many easy marks on P7. So analytical procedures need to be carried out, and then number three, observation and inspection. So for example, you're probably going to observe controls. Because if we're assessing risk, well, observation of controls will be fundamental because we want to understand what controls are in place and therefore where there is a risk of perhaps a control failure. When it comes to inspection, I want you to get away from thinking about inspection of assets because generally that's what students think of here. I want you to think inspection of documents. So we're thinking invoices, control procedures, those sorts of things to inspect during this risk assessment procedure. So those procedures must be carried out in order to understand the risks. But the next question we need to think about is why? Why are we doing this? Well, you could structure this into two areas. First of all, it will enable us to understand the entity. And ISA 315 says there are various areas that we must understand in the entity. First of all, we must understand the industry and the regulations that affect that entity. Because remember, changes in regulations will increase audit risk. Maybe there's a change that they haven't dealt with properly, and that could be reflected in the financial statements. We also have other areas such as operations. Problems in operations could lead to inability to complete orders, which could lead to going concern issues, for example. Governance. Anytime you see governance failures in a scenario, you must mention it as a risk. Because if there's poor governance, it's much more likely that audit risk will increase. Because we are reliant on management for internal controls and a strong control environment. And if the business is poorly governed, that's unlikely to be happening. Ownership is important because you need to assess, is there a risk that perhaps the owners have an incentive to manipulate the accounts? Maybe they own it privately and they're thinking about selling or listing, in which case it's in their interest to overstate revenue and profit. So ownership is important in gaining that understanding to enable us to understand what risks will apply. The accounting policies, because obviously we need to understand the accounting policies in order to audit them. The objectives of the organisation, particularly around targets set for management. If they're under too much pressure to meet targets, once again, they may be under pressure to manipulate the financial statements. Therefore, we need to be alive to that possibility. And of course, the strategic direction of the organisation. That will enable us to understand, are there perhaps foreign exchange risks because they've expanded into overseas territories, or are there potential cash flow problems through overtrading? All of those risks can be identified through gaining an understanding of the entity. The second aspect will be understanding the controls within the entity. We need to understand the control environment. Remember, that will feed in from the ownership and the governance, because weak governance will usually lead to a weak control environment, which will lead to higher risk because there's a risk that those controls are inadequate. Risk assessment procedures should be carried out within the firm. We need to understand them and see if those are adequate. If not, that's going to increase our audit risk. Information systems, remember, the information that is provided is only as good as the system that provided it. Weak systems, increased audit risk, because a weak system gives us more likelihood that we're going to get rubbish, basically going into the accounts. And of course, overlying all of this, there should be monitoring systems. Remember that the board are charged with ensuring internal controls are adequate, so they should have some systems in place to monitor that and basically do their job. So that was just a quick session to say, right, when do we do the risk assessment? That is before the year end. What do we do during it? We do those required procedures of inquiries of management, analytical procedures, observation and inspection. And why do we do it? We do it to understand the entity and understand the controls, because those will feed directly into our audit risk and the risk of us expressing an inappropriate opinion.